It's always an interesting exercise to break through your cultural conditioning, and I'm going to offer you that opportunity today with our guests, Timothy Freke and Peter Gandy. They're back with more information on the ancient Gnostics, and you know, whether we dare to question the Big Bang Theory and other fundamental so-called facts, or the origins of Christianity and the authenticity of a historical Jesus. Well, we always look to the history, to the mythology, to the evidence and how it's accumulated, and as these two gentlemen say, we're only looking for the simplest and most obvious way to account for the evidence that they have amassed through the scholarly sources and through long years of study. And welcome back, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Hello, Timothy.
Hi.
Peter.
Hi.
Their newest book is Jesus and the Lost Goddess, the Secret Teachings of the Original Christians, and their earlier book, The Jesus Mysteries, was the original Jesus, the pagan god. So the basic theory that you've looked at is that the story of Jesus looks so similar to other godmen of the Mediterranean that this story grew out of a series of ongoing mythologies.
Well, it seems a remarkable coincidence otherwise, because what we can find in the myths told in the ancient Mediterranean pagan world is all the elements make up the Jesus story. So we can find the story of a son of God who's a God-man, born of a virgin, who is born on the 25th of December before three shepherds, who turns water into wine, who baptizes his followers, who does miraculous acts, all the way through to dying at Easter and sometimes by crucifixion, arising after 3 days, and his followers taking wine and bread as symbols of his body and blood to commune with him. Now, that is the Jesus story, and yet we find that pre-existing in the pagan world. So what Peter and I set out to do with the Jesus mysteries was try and account for how that could be.
Well, you ask a logical question. You say, why do we read essentially the same account in pagan literature? Your cyber myths, the Dionysus myths, Mismo, so many other myths, and then we recognize it so readily as allegory, as mythic, a mythic story. We don't expect it to be literally true. And yet we read essentially the same story you point out in the Bible, and we take this as a biography of a carpenter from Bethlehem.
Well, it's so deep in our culture. I mean, we rely for a lot of our evidence on the Gnostic Gospels, which were found in the Egyptian desert in 1945. And they show a completely different kind of Christianity than the one we're used to. For the early Christians, it is a myth. Now, what would happen if we didn't have the New Testament, but we suddenly discovered it today? Who would really believe that these stories of somebody who turned water into wine and walked on water and came back from the dead were actually true? We would see them as quite clearly a myth. But it's getting that kind of objectivity. When you're brought up with something, it's very hard to break your conceptual mindset and to accept that it is a myth. But it's there for everybody to see if you can just break away from your conditioning.
You know, your book, The Jesus Mysteries, has been out for some time and now in paperback, and I find some of the comments coming in, even from the Bible Belt, this comment from the Fort Worth Star-Telegram, whether you conclude that this book is the most alarming heresy of the millennium or the mother of all revelations, The Jesus Mysteries deserves to be read. What kind of reaction have you had thus far with this?
Overwhelmingly, it's been a fantastic reaction. We've had a scholarly support. It's now being taught in some American universities, for instance. We've had some great reviews from other scholars. But more importantly, I think we've had great support from ordinary readers and a lot of people who felt they were stuck in Christianity. A lot of fundamentalists email us with messages saying, now, I was stuck in this for 20 years, I knew there was something wrong, and then finally I feel free. And the joy which comes across in these emails is just immense, the sense of freedom, the sense of new possibilities. The only sadness is that sometimes they feel like their old friends don't talk to them anymore. And this is the sadness, of course, of fundamentalism. It's a closed thing, you're either in or you're out. So people who wake up from that mindset and suddenly see new possibilities are often thrown out. So that's the sadness. But apart from that, there's great joy, and we do get hostility. We haven't received any death threats, but we've received an awful lot of after death threats, if some fundamentalists are to be believed, then Jesus and God have got a little torture chamber set up specifically for Peter and I to get even with us for eternity. Which kind of shows the sort of God that you end up with when you've got a fundamentalist mindset. Who do that? You know, it's certainly not the God that I think the original Christians had, who was very much a God of love and forgiveness.
But it's always a sign of their own insecurity. We've had people come up to us at bookshops when we're doing tours, and they are quaking. I mean, they are literally shaking. They are profoundly convinced of the truth of the literal Jesus and all the rest of it, and this cuts right to the core of their own being. Those people who are able to say, oh, I see, yeah, it's a myth, like all the other myths, I get it, are generally relaxed and able to open up their own boundaries. And what you begin to realize is that a lot of people's open-mindedness is to do with their beginning in life. You know, if you're filled with fear, then you're not able to open up to these new possibilities.
But you don't just take away an historical Jesus. You guys put back a truly spiritual quest and message, which we'll get to talk to a little bit later on, but I have some other comments and questions for you first. I know the wrath of fundamentalist Christians personally, because early in my radio career, when I was a little more naive, we had a woman on, Margaret Starbird, who talked about that there was a heresy in the 12th century, the Albigensians, and this is what they thought or whatever.
Yeah.
And so she's telling us this story, and Monday morning, my show was on the weekend, Monday morning I get a call from our general manager at the station, and he says, gee, I've had some complaints, would you mind coming in and just want to hear your side of the story? So I go in there, and he's telling me that one of our new sponsors was a Christian and did not hear the interview with Margaret Starbird, but heard about it through a friend, and has called up and wanted to get me fired and pulled her advertising and blah, 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 and was in an outrage. And he said, my God, what happened? And I said, well, here's what the woman said, our guest said, and she's not saying there wasn't a Jesus. She wasn't saying that Jesus was married. That's what that art said.
Mm-hmm.
She was just saying that this was a tradition in the 12th century and here's historically and all of this. Mm-hmm. We said, well, you deal with her. So I had to call her up and say, gosh, did you listen to it? No, I didn't hear it. I wouldn't listen to heresy like that. I said, well, this is what she said. I don't care. I just don't want to support any show that would question, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I said, okay, fine. Let an in-house here. Thank you very much. But I thought, gee, what a reaction.
Yeah.
So when you travel on people's heartfelt, desperate beliefs,
I mean, the whole journey, it seems that the journey of Gnosis, which we will get into later, the idea of the teachings that the Christians want to encode in this story, is about freeing you from your mindset. We're all walking around in an idea of what life is, an idea of who we are. And they want to set us free into the genuine mystery of existence, into realizing what a mystery it is that we are, what a miracle that anything is at all. And
look around you, and you see the wonder,
that
we're right here.
That we're talking to each other, and that other people are listening, and that we can, you know, the consciousness can reach out to itself, and what is all of that? Now, that's what they want to wake us up to. What gets in the way of that is our ideas that we fall asleep into of what life is. So we're busy, most of us, I guess, going around with the time, going, I'm this, doing this, I'm this person, doing that, whatever it is.
And to make our own mental constructs is to not to trust the process that God has right here for us.
Mm-hmm. Exactly right. Now, if you've got the fundamentalist mind, what we do in the new book, right at the beginning of the new book, Jesus and the Lost Goddess, is we say, look, we've got to get away from dividing up religious or spiritual groups according to their regions. Because if we do that, we end up pagans over here, and Jews over here, and the Persians doing this, that over here, or whoever it is. That is helpful to a degree. What's much more interesting, however, is to divide people up according to their understanding. So that on the one hand, we have literalists, what we call literalists, people who take all of this literally. Their books are literally written by God. This is the fundamentalist, ultimately the fundamentalist mind.
This is the form of elitism. My God is the right God, God.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, form of tribalism.
Yeah, completely. And it will, and what happens is that you get associated with particular peoples. Yeah, clearly with the Jews. But on the other hand, there's what we call Gnostics or mystics. And what marks out the mystics is the opposite, that they don't take it literally. They regard it all about waking up to a revelation of what's happening in this moment. Everything all their teachings and their scriptures are fingers pointing to something, not the thing in itself.
And it's a direct route to God. It's between you and God directly,
yeah.
Not you through your community or your tribal identity or your particular religion.
And through an experience that can't be put into words. So therefore any words you use to define it, God, Allah, whatever you are secondary. They're after the fact.
They're the fingers pointing.
This is all, and every symbol, a piece of artwork, a piece of sculpture, whatever, becomes an idol, becomes something that is meant to represent this mystery,
but of course falls short.
But comes to actually be held to be the mystery in itself, and that is the ultimate blasphemy, is to make any
way of doing. Switch that's going on in consciously.
Yeah, because the thing itself is beyond words.
So what you've got is, on the one hand, what you could call religion, and on the other hand, you could call mysticism or Gnosticism. And religion, actually, I mean, we come out in the new book and just say it boldly at the end. I mean, we just look, but mythically I'm speaking now, not literally, of course, but religion is the work of the devil. It's, we say religion is the devil's greatest achievement, because what it does is divide us from each other. Whereas what mysticism is about, where the original impulse, it's all about uniting. It's all about, and what you notice about the Gnostics, and it's from this Gnostic spirit that Christianity is born, is that it sees no divisions. So they all agree with each other. Pagan Gnostics, Jewish Gnostics, agree with each other. They're seeing the same vision. There's no division between them. They can draw on each other's
text. Because you see it as variations on the same theme.
Yeah, precisely. And this is why
experience coloring it.
And this is why they, and only they, are able to synthesize pagan and Jewish ideas to create Christianity. Because they don't see any division between them. Because what they're looking for is the proof. Something which goes way beyond all these divisions. But the other extreme, the religious people, these are the people that the mystics are attacking and trying to free up. They see all those divisions. They are the people who want to mark us all out as different to each other. And that's the fundamentalist mindset. And what they're doing is they're defending themselves from their fear of the mystery with this mindset. And what the Gnostics are saying is, it's okay, the mystery isn't frightening. You can let go of all of that armor plating, conceptual armor plating, and surrender into life, because life will catch you, it's safe.
Trust the process.
Trust the process, you don't need to be frightened. So when Pete says we have these young fundamentalists often come up shaking, then I found the best thing to do is give them a hug and just go, it's okay, because they're only fundamentalists because they're fundamentally frightened. Well, they can see that life is not, that life is okay, that it's fundamentally good, then there's no need for that armor plating.
Is it a particular personality type? I mean, I look at the mystery and I feel the breath of it, you know, you feel the winds of it flow through your hair, and I'm just going, oh yeah, I like that. Is that the experience that scares other people, or is it just a different personality type? Is it a psychological thing? Is it the way you were raised? Is it?
Well, I think the intriguing thing is, if you say to a fundamentalist, say a fundamentalist Christian, in the States, as we have them. Look, if you were born in Algeria or Iraq, and you were brought up in a Muslim culture, do you really think you would be a Christian now? Or do you think you would be a fundamentalist Islamic? Because actually it's the mindset that is the same, and the set of beliefs that it will jump onto can be anything. Mahatma Gandhi was killed by a Hindu fundamentalist. You know, the Buddhists who did that gapping in Japan, you know, they're Buddhist fundamentalists. So
flavor fundamentalism, but for one who's primarily, I have a material view of the world. What I see is what I get. I want to hang on to this physical reality, as opposed to, well, this is just all a mirage anyway, and the real juice is in the spiritual realm. Those are two different categories of people that two different lenses through which you see the world and yourself in it.
That's completely right. And what the Christians do, the original Christians, is a really good analysis of this, because they divide people up into different types, different stages. Hylics, which just means materialists, are people who...
Can you spell it?
H-Y-L-I-C.
Okay.
And these are people who are who think they're the body completely, to identify with that anyway, and in the world, and what they think that's what it is. It's all very literal, as you say, and that's their level of awareness. But they say when you wake up, you move into the psychic level of initiation, where you wake up to your psyche or soul, and you start discovering an interiority. And then there'll be another level, the pneumatic or spiritual initiation, where you start to discover consciousness itself. And gnosis, where you discover the oneness of all things directly, non-conceptually, you have gnosis, direct knowledge. So they've got there actually a model for the exact steps, I think, that people take. Fundamentalists are hillocks. They're people who are stuck in a mindset who think that is literally how it is. They can't step back enough from their ideas to go, well, of course, these are just my ideas. What marks out, I think, people who, as they progress, and just mature, really, it's just a maturing process, is that you notice, first of all, they've got a great sense of humor about their ideas, because they don't take them so seriously, so they can laugh about it. And they can pick them up and drop them, because they're always looking for the thing the idea is pointing to, not the idea itself, so they're not precious about these things. They're not, you know, you haven't got all that tightness around them, because ideas are seen as what they are, ideas.
And it's part of this landmark on the journey.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
You might pass that landmark and get to the next one.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah, but people cling to these things like they have so much invested in. And often, it's especially true, I think, with spiritual awakening, is that it is something quite shocking, often it's a loss, a bereavement, that flips somebody into some kind of spiritual awakening. They suddenly, the world's not enough, there has to be something else, what have you. And they find some spiritual solace for their grief, but then they cling on to it for a long time. It becomes the thing which is actually a bulwark against more pain, more. And what we're trying to say is, look, once you have found this thing, once you've made this awakening, you can go on to a further awakening, but only by letting go of this one thing that you're clinging.
The light's brighter down the tunnel. Keep going.
Keep going. Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, there's definitely a phenomenon, I think, most people would, where if you have an awakening experience of any type at all, you do, as Pete's saying, if you happen to be in a Christian environment, you go, aha, it's Christianity. But it isn't. It's just awakening. It happens to be through that. If you happen to when you're taking drugs, it's aha, it's drugs. It's not. It just happened to you when you were taking drugs, and these things won't necessarily continue to do it for you. You have to find out what it is in itself. But
that's when your inner voice starts kicking in and leads you to the next step if you'll listen.
Absolutely, and you'll move on. And of course, that wouldn't necessarily. You might have to explore Christianity for a while. I mean, I think Pete and I are able to be okay with the fundamentalist attackers because we can look at it and go, well, that was us at a different stage of our life. I mean, I wasn't a Christian fundamentalist, but Pete was a bit, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
And I was a kind of Hindu fundamentalist, I suppose. I mean, I had a guru, and he was literally the Lord of the universe, and, you know, I was a teenager, and that's where it was. And
we would have battles, the two of us. We would have
arguing
of who could... Who could have
Yeah, it wasn't Peter, was it?
I had a real firm scientist friend who, you know, was a real... Just a firm scientist, but a firm scientist. I mean, he was a big believer in Tesla and looking for the energy, the subtle energies and all of this from a scientific mindset. And he called me up one day and he said, God, I had an experience where I imbibed this and it just woke me up in a way. And he went and joined a Christian fundamentalist cult because he said, well, they've got the, you know, they know how to embody and take the Holy Spirit inside of them and deal with it. So he wanted to go explore that, and I've never heard from him since. But, you know, so I think, or the Quakers, we talked to a Quaker woman who said that's where I felt people knew how to handle this when it just comes inside of you, and it's not just an intellectual exercise.
One of the great problems we've got, and I think it's an area that we want to move into, and now we've worked specifically with Christianity, is that what's happening culturally is that we're distinguishing religion from spirituality, I think, and that's partly what we're doing in the second book, Jesus and the Lost Goddess, is going, look, we need to understand what this spirituality is. And the future seems to be one in which we're becoming secular, we're seeing the power of science differentiated itself from religion, and it's been immensely good for us, it's been very powerful, it's given us all of this. and yet there's danger of losing something, losing spirituality, and people aren't willing to do that. People are just as spiritual now as they've ever been, perhaps more so. But I think there is a feeling that people don't want religion. And what we would want to keep pointing to, this essence, this gnosis, this, what the Christians call the gospel of gnosis, the good news of enlightenment, you could call it, that this is about state of being, this is about discovering for yourself what you are. And that doesn't have anything to do with religion. So if we can differentiate that and make that available, then people won't be in the position that when they awaken, they have to go, oh God, where can I get some advice on this? Well, I'll go to my local church and just put up with whatever they're given. But they've actually got the option of doing it in a new way, doing it in a way that suits them, making a clear
having an open road map so that you can find your own path amidst many options to the same goal.
Yeah, because we live in an eclectic world now, and rather than pushing that away as superficial, which I think is some people want us to do, usually people are embedded in one particular tradition, I think actually it's a great opportunity because, well, Christianity came out of eclecticism. It comes out of the ability to see the one thing in anything, to find the common factor, and bring out the essence. You're much less likely to get stuck in a particular tradition or a particular mindset if you're doing that.
And I think historically that's been the process, is that with the Enlightenment, which was only achieved after huge bloodshed in Europe, the Reformation I'm talking about now, the Protestants and the Catholics, and out of that, the wars of religion, came the Enlightenment, when most people just went, no, we've had enough of religion, it's caused so much trouble, that's it. And so, with Voltaire and everybody after him, religion has had a dirty name. And what happened, I think, was the Enlightenment threw the baby out with the bathwater. They threw all of that away, and left it. And so science, which developed then, has come with a very bleak, materialistic viewpoint. We're just monkeys who came down out of trees completely accidentally. We're clinging to a rock, hurtling through meaningless space. And it's a very bleak picture.
But that's not our personal experience.
And that's not our personal experience. And what we're trying to do is to say, look, you threw away all of religion with the Enlightenment, but actually spirituality is the valuable thing that's in there. And the extraordinary thing is that none of the scientists who've made the whole scientific endeavor possible were actually materialists themselves.
They were all mystics.
Newton and Kepler and Einstein, and you could go on and on and on. They were all out-and-out mystics.
But you see, what's so fascinating, I think, Laura, is you see the same process that we were talking about with, I mean, really it's not religious ideology, because you can see the same process happening in science as happened with Christianity, or happened with Islam, which is science is inspired by fundamentally what we could call Gnostics. These are people who've got a deep sense of the mystery of life, searching for ways of understanding it, have a deeply mystical understanding of what it is to exist. And they create a science which, as it then becomes part of the mainstream culture, is literalist.
It's
about, you know, people think science says, you know, materiality is what there is, and the rest doesn't exist. Science doesn't say that. It doesn't say that materiality is all there is. It says, in fact, materiality doesn't exist. So these people were mystics. They've got a completely other perspective. And the same thing, it's the same movement from the early Christians to the Roman Church, from the influential scientists, Albert Einstein, Eddington, these sort of people, down to the modern view of what science is telling us. And what we have to do is just keep going back to the Gnostic impulse.
But it is interesting how, and it's been, you know, observed on the show a lot by how the scientific paradigm in mindset is invoked to say, well, that near-death experience was just a brain chemical finding, and well, that psi stuff is just really imagination, or it's been staked in the lab, or, you know.
The word you always got to look out for is just.
Yeah.
It's when they come in and they go, it's just your imagination, or it's just your brain, and it's not just, it's as well.
Right. Why can't we have a mystical experience that does the firing of the brain chemicals and allows us to be a material aspect to us and a spiritual aspect?
It's a sure sign, because it's a disappearing trick. When somebody says, oh, it's just so-and-so in your brain, or, you know, it's just a disappearing trick. That's what they're doing with it.
Well, we just don't need the scientific seal of approval to answer all questions now and then put our own personal experience and intuition off to the side. We just don't need to do that anymore.
Well, that's none of the great...
We're throwing off the yoke of authority to tell us what to do, because it's a do-it-yourself, spiritual path that we're all on.
Yeah.
Make it up as you go.
Yeah.
I have a question for you. It used to be, back when the Gnostics had their heyday and the pagans' mysteries were all over the place, that you had a choice of, and you had some counsel, and you knew that there was a roadmap and some guidance along the way. Yeah, it was between you and God or the goddess, but you had guidance and you had people saying, you know, hey, try this, do this, do this. Now it's really you make it up as you go along, truly. I mean, there's a big smorgasbord to choose from. You can go the Hindu route or the Christian route or the pagan route or the whatever route you want to do. Or you can sit in your own room and stare at your navel. I don't know. So many choices. It's up to you to figure it out for yourself. But do you believe that it's less difficult, more difficult, back then as now, to really go through that development that is our destiny? I think we are destined to develop the soul through those stages that you talked about. Or can we just the process of living, and it will happen eventually?
I think it's a fascinating question, and one that we couldn't possibly actually answer.
But that's kind of an opinion.
But, I would give my feeling. I mean, I don't know if it'll be the same as yours, Steve, but my feeling, I have a deep sense of the evolution of consciousness through history. That this is the evolution of the one in search of itself. That's what we call history. And therefore, I have a feeling that it's in fact easier now, that that consciousness is moving forward all the time. See, I think it's very easy, and perhaps we were guilty of this ourselves in the Jesus mysteries, of contrasting paganism as some sort of positive thing as against Roman Christianity when it came across as some sort of negative thing. And partly that's true. Paganism had the virtue of being very much more open-minded, but pagans were literalists too. I'm sure if you've gone back to the pagan world, you've been like being in India. You've been just as appalled by the crazy, literalist, religious things the pagans were doing. It wasn't all
ritual. We can't divide the line and say this is all bad and this is all good, because it's all a mix anyway. And let me come back. I want your opinion, Peter, on this question as we continue our conversation with Timothy Freke and Peter Gandy. Two books, must reading. The first, The Jesus Mysteries, was the original Jesus, the pagan god, and their latest, Jesus and the Lost Goddess, the Secret Teachings of the Original Christians. Both available at the radio bookstore, and we'll give you their website when we come back. I'm moving. I love reviving what the Gnostics knew. I've always been curious if that's been cut off, if the Roman Empire did such a good job of burying that whole wisdom tradition. It's nice to have it restructured where we can look at it again and give it its rightful place in spiritual options and history. I wanted to hear from you, Peter, next, what your thoughts were. Do we need a structure as we once had thousands of years ago to help the spiritual evolution, or is it still...
Well, I think it's there in the life...
Built in.
It's there built in the life process itself. I think all the Gnostics have done is yes, certainly they have looked at the spiritual path and divided it into stages. But I think these are things that happen naturally. As Tim said, there are three stages along the path, and they relate very much to something that happens throughout life anyway. The first stage of life is about building a healthy body. That's what happens in the first phase of your life. And that's what the Gnostics would call hilic, the physical state. After that comes the building of a solid ego, a personality, one that is durable, that will survive. But then you go out into the world, and that's when a spiritual awakening should happen to you. And I think in an awful lot of cases it does happen. What I think you've got to be on the guard against is then choosing not to keep on going forward into that greater awakening, but to settle wherever you are. So I think there is a natural process anyway, but it can be formulated into a spiritual path. But if we are moving forward into a time of less organized religion, which is what we always previously had in the past, whereas this has been organized from without, now I think we do need some... I suffer from the same thing. I walk into one of these huge spiritual bookshops, and it is so bewildering. You can come away going, well, can it all be true? Can it really, you know, all of these, how do they fit together? Whereas I think, you know, possibly that there is some value in having some kind of understanding that there are divisions, that people are at different stages in their awakening. But how that was come about, I mean, the whole idea is that nobody organizes it from without, because that would seem to be to open up the same problem. Who are we going to trust to say, right, you're at this stage, you're at that stage? I mean,
Joseph Campbell did a wonderful job of synthesizing all of those various traditions and saying, look, here's a roadmap, here's mm-hmm. what it's really talking mm-hmm. about in all of its yeah. various yeah. aspects.
Yeah.
It seems to be a message whose time is now.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Joseph Campbell was very important for doing this. And I think what he did was he was able to bring out the perennial journey and put it into a language which we could understand today. What we try to do in Jesus and the Lost Goddess is the same thing. Now, Jesus and the God, and the Jesus Mystery, in our first book, is very much focused on the history of Christianity. And the second book, Jesus and the Lost Goddess, is very much focusing on the meaning of Christianity, bringing out from this body of mythology the spiritual message in the same way, or a different way, but in the same spirit as Joseph Campbell has done with many, many myths. Because I think we can't look at the future in terms of old myths. We can't look back and hope to go back anywhere. We can only go forward. And I don't feel that for many people it's going to be a matter of going back to the goddess as a mythic figure. Although if individuals want to, that's absolutely fine, of course. But I don't see that reviving a mythic myth which has died now is going to help. And I don't think the future will be changing Christianity around its domestic Christianity, because I think its mythos is kind of dead on us now. If I wanted to choose an image to put across the idea of transcending myself, I'm not sure I would choose the figure of a man being tortured to death on a cross. But 2,000 years ago, that was clearly a vivid image, and that's what they chose. And not just them, but of course the pagans as well. So things have changed, and we need to re-understand this in a modern way. But we need to go back and find out what it is, find out what the Gnosis was, and then move it forward. And I think that's what Joseph Campbell was trying to do, and I think that's what we're trying to do.
How did these mythic stories get started? Are there selected mythographers? Does it grow like a new leaf budding on a vine that continues to grow forward? What is the process?
It's the telling of stories. I mean, this is one thing that, you know, I always wondered about the Greeks. They're famous for producing myths, as if it was, you know, like some people produce colored blankets and other people produce incense, and the Greeks produce myths. That's how I kind of saw it. Now I see it's very much as they were encoding a lot of teachings, and some of which we unpick in Jesus and the Lost Goddess. They were encoding spiritual teachings into profound myths that go on being told to this day, and that's because the meaning is not, it's not something that is immediately apparent. It's a great story, but then it can keep on developing, keep on opening up new things. And certainly, a lot of things do change. The Cinderella story, for example, is very, very close to the Gnostic stories. I would suggest that there's some line which follows straight through. You know, Cinderella is the princess.
You have time, let's hear it.
She's come down into the underworld, which is the same thing as the fall of the soul into incarnation. She's waiting for her redeemer, who is the prince, who will come and take her back to her rightful place. So this story, even though it's a children's story, a fairy story, encodes teachings which are incredibly profound. And the ancient world was very good at doing that, and I think that's the way into all of these myths is the multiple meanings that they can open up for you.
Andy Newberg was by a few months ago, and with his research that we are hardwired in our brains for seeking God, for seeking meaning in life.
Mm-hmm.
And we also have a tendency to like to take things and put a beginning, middle, and end to them, put characters to them, anthropomorphize mm-hmm. things, to make them stories. We just have a way to categorize our experience of life by telling stories. So I would think those two together would be part of that innate drive to create a myth that resonates with our soul, that speaks to some, whispers some truth mm-hmm. to us,
mm-hmm.
and also is in a story form that can be enjoyed by children. It can be enjoyed on many levels, like a good Shakespeare play.
Mm-hmm.
It's just part of how we function, isn't it?
I think that's absolutely right, but I think the Gnostics will push that even further and go, look, the reason that we do this is because we are a story.
trust you? How would they say?
Because our existence, our personal existence as a separate individual, for them is a kind of a dream, is a kind of a fantasy, a kind of story which God is telling. God is dreaming this, or goddess, or the mystery, let's say, is imagining this whole universe.
You're the players on the stage?
And we are the players on the stage, and each one of us is actually an expression of the one.
Okay.
And we are playing out the story. And within that, we create stories of doing that. And not only do we do that in our stories, but, you know, we've got to just look at modern technology, how we're creating virtual realities, which model the fact that we are ourselves living in a kind of virtual reality, or so the Gnostics would say. So we mirror back to ourselves in our art and in our philosophy something about the very truth of our being. So the storytelling mirrors back to us the fact that we are a story. When the Gnostics are revealing that Jesus is you, there is no real Jesus, they're also saying there's no real you. They're mirroring back to you a very, very profound teaching, that as an individual, your existence is relative, because actually there is only God. Actually, there is only the One.
So we are a part of God, living out this lifetime. So are you, so are you, so are you. So we're all God, just having a little soiree, a little party, and we all put on these masks, and we all run around.
Yes, well, coming to know itself.
Writing our scripts as we go.
That's the whole
coming
process.
Coming to know itself.
Yeah. It starts in unconsciousness and comes right through consciousness to self-consciousness.
God doesn't want to sit around just being. That's kind of boring in Trinity. Or wants to
in the Gnostic mythology.
Becoming explicate and playing and dancing. And
In the Gnostic mythology, in the beginning is pure mystery. But the mystery desires to know itself, what itself is.
How does it
and
do
so it creates a cosmos, which is a kind of mirror through which it comes to know itself. And this is the unfolding of the whole Gnostic mythology.
Now that makes much more sense to me than the Big Bang Theory.
Well,
I don't believe
it. It's kind of another version of, you could say, the Big Bang Theory is a myth. But that this fundamental division which Peter's talking about, is as if it was a mural. So turning its consciousness, if you like. If you imagine pure consciousness, conscious of nothing. It's unconscious. You're in a paradox. And so the ancients call this, the Christians call this, the dazzling darkness, because like light that has nothing to reflect on, it's dark. And consciousness, which is unconscious of anything, is unconscious.
There's a reason for duality, right?
Yeah, precisely. Because without it, you're asleep. You know that for yourself. You merge into the dazzling darkness every single night of your life.
You go home.
And you go back into the One, and it's blissful, and it's gorgeous, and it's lovely, and you're not there, and there's no consciousness. And something propels you out of it to come back to consciousness, and that's the same thing for which the Gnostics is propelling the whole of this universe into existence, which allows the One to come into consciousness of itself. And that fundamental division between consciousness and what it's conscious of, that is what they mean by the God and Goddess, or Christ and the Goddess, as it is in the Christian tradition. That is the fundamental way to understand what all of these myths are pointing to. They're pointing to the idea that the appearances, the whole multiplicity of all that is, the richness of all qualities, is the Goddess within which we exist. And what's witnessing that, what is aware of that, what's the empty space of consciousness which contains all of that, is the hidden father or God.
But the womb of the universe.
Is containing all of that. And that's the primal duality which the Gnostics are then exploring, coming down to many, many levels, the manifesting as you and I, and the duality that we're experiencing. And the Gnostic journey is one back. It's one of making the loop back to the One, but staying conscious, because we start as One, but unconscious, and the goal is to come back to the One, but being conscious. So the One becomes two to know that it's One, or the One becomes many, if you like, to know that it's One. And we are that. For them, that's what we are. That's what this is. This is the one thing, the one consciousness of the universe, which they call the Christ.
So they really want to see the end of war and the end of conflict. That's when the majority of us get to realize consciously, oh, we're all one. So you don't want to war against yourself.
Absolutely.
Or God.
Yeah.
You know, it's all the same bed we're sleeping in.
The only way.
Make it a pleasant one.
And I think that's why consciousness has become embodied in so many different people, because you contact the other. If I was living in a world in which other people weren't autonomous beings, I would be autistic, or I would be asleep and dreaming. In dreams, these aren't automatons. I create the whole thing. Whereas in reality, although it has that same dream-like quality, and you can feel it, you can feel it has the same quality, you discover other consciousnesses which are independent. And that is how the mirror really, really works. Inside the other person is the same consciousness that is in you, the same beingness. And I think it's that the heart of all morality can only come about with that understanding that it's all one, that you can't attack and destroy somebody else because they are you.
So the God in you recognizes the God in you
exactly,
as the same God.
Exactly.
And that's what we call love. When that happens, that's what we call love.
And that's what binds.
And it's something which is the most truthful and beautiful feeling that a human being can have. And I think anyone experiences that knows that. You can't miss that. You just know that. But that's what you should do. That's what you want to feel. It's when you recognize that oneness with one person, a crowd of people, the universe, as much as you can. And that's why the gospel, the good news that the Gnostics are teaching, is love. Is the idea of loving your enemies, loving your neighbors. God is love. You hear it?
Because you're at the scouts where it's all one.
Where it's all one.
Yeah. And you recognize
we are one thing exploring itself.
And once you recognize that, you behave very differently.
You behave very differently, and you're living in a miracle. You're living in this, you're no longer living in your mindset, to go back to the beginning of our conversation.
In your true companionship.
You're in the mystery. You're in the mystery of love. You're on a mythic journey in the mystery of love, as well as going through exactly the same life that you've always been going through.
Chop wood, carry water, the same thing, but your interior experience of it is much more extensive.
You just know how miraculous it is to chop wood and carry water.
Going back in history, was there a time, do you suppose, you see the evidence of it, where the Gnostics had the majority mindset going on, where these were practiced, where laws and institutions were based upon this understanding?
Oh, yes.
And then let's talk later about how the Roman Empire really tried to squash this and bury it, and then the Malachimati and other indications. Is it all springing from the same source that will flower?
I think it springs up all over the place, and it's flourished throughout history. There have been moments when it really comes to the surface. I think one of those great flowerings was the Renaissance itself in Florence. All of the works of Plato and other pagan philosophers arrived in this small city-state and inspired incredible work. You can go back before that, the Cathars in southern France and northern Italy. Created incredible, the troubadour culture, fabulously wealthy and a high culture. But again, these things have been viciously destroyed. You can go back again to Alexandria, for example, or before that in classical Athens, times when it's flourished. But sadly, there has always been a reactionary backlash against those forces of freeing the spirit, because that's what you see, is wherever the spirit is freed, there is a magnificent cultural flowering. But that represents a definite threat to other people who
want to lord it over the rest of us?
Well, it's you don't have the control. I mean, the whole thing about Gnosticism versus literalism. Gnosticism is very much finding your own personal relationship with the cosmos, with whatever you conceive God to be. But organized religion is no, you can only find access to God through us, the priests, through us, the church. And it's very much about establishing control.
Well, it seems with the Roman Empire, it looks like, from Mark's vantage point, they're going, gee, we tried politics and look what happened, falling apart here, let's just go for religion and really control people. You know, grab them by the soul.
Mm-hmm.
You've done a lot of historical...
I think it's happened. I mean, you look at times in ancient Egypt, where it was a theocracy. It was a place run by priests. Now, for occasional periods, that was fantastic. But for a lot of the time, the reason why ancient Egypt didn't change was because it was run by priests. And once you have an absolute story that is absolutely true,
and it stops growing.
Now, then there was a period when the Greeks were in control of the Mediterranean, there was no organized priesthood. there was no organized body of text that were the sacred text. There was nobody enforcing a religious orthodoxy. And there was a tremendous flowering. All of the cultures that bordered the Mediterranean contributed to their own, and Alexandria in ancient Egypt was a fantastic place where some Pythagoreans and Jews and all sorts mingled and mixed and created a fabulous culture. But eventually that succumbed to the same process that had happened in ancient Egypt. A theocracy arose, priests who were controlling the law, what could be and could not be believed, and as that came the Holy Roman Empire, the Christian Church, with priests in control, and what happened in Europe was 1,000 years of dark ages. Nothing happened. Nothing changed, because nothing could change. There was no possibility. Only with the Renaissance, as I've said, with the introduction of other ways of looking at the world, could the possibility of comparative mythology, comparative religion, open things up for people.
And I similar to what's happening today.
Exactly.
Everything's available right now. We know more, we can look back in history, we can look at the evidence, we can use forensic,
And just as we're seeing the rise of fundamentalism, which opposes that, which sees that as something that dilutes the character of it, because it's very nationalistic, usually, as well. It's seen as something which is weakening the culture or corrupting it in some way. What it's actually doing is creating amazing new combinations. I mean, I love it. But there are people who want things to be just so and just under control. And
well, that's fine for them, but the rest of us need to be able to find it. And I guess I was reading a wonderful Huna book about the Kahunas and their ancient religion, and their feeling was, by Max Freedom Long, written in the 1940s, where he still had some of the Kahunas to talk to and to see their philosophy and their ritual magic and all that. And they said the only sin is to hurt someone else, whether intentionally or unintentionally. It's the only sin. So as long as we can practice that, it seems that I love the diversity and the party of it and the dance and the exploration and the... Hey, let's compare notes and...
Clearly, the one wants to be the many in as many possible ways as it can. I mean, that seems to be obvious if you just look around you. It wants that variety. It wants to experiment in all directions. But it doesn't want to hurt itself. And that's simply which gives rise to that ethic of, well, don't hurt others. It's a way of going, look, you know, we're one thing. We don't hurt ourselves. And that's what we must avoid doing. But apart from that, within that, then we need the more freedom, the more creativity,
the more fun.
Absolutely.
Can we have some fun? That's hard enough.
This, what you're articulating now, is the Gnostic spirit, and this is the same thing you find with the original Christians. They're criticized so much because they have this spirit. So then they're free spirits, they're doing what they want to do, they're open sexually, they're open to they're saying, look, all morals are just human creations. What matters is love, because if you're in love, then you don't do bad things to each other. It's just natural. You don't need all these rules and regulations. You need to find that you yourself are good already.
And if you're responsible for yourself, then you don't need to be responsible for the person over here. That's their responsibility for themselves.
But we
offer guidance, we offer compassion, we offer help, but we're not trying to control other people.
I think it's two views of human nature. And I think there's a let's call it fundamentalist view of human nature, which is that it's fundamentally bad. And that it needs controlling. We need laws to control people, because human nature is, you know, people are actually nasty, selfish, greedy, and we need to control them. And then there's another view of human nature, which is that it's fundamentally good. And that what it needs is the right conditions for it to flower and to, you know, to offer it all of the resources in which it can come to an understanding of that. And let's take the doctrine of original sin, which was imposed on Christianity.
Was it part of the original?
It wasn't part of the original. So it's just St. Augustine. If you go back and read his, you know, there was a man who was terrified of his own nature. And that's why he became this stern, repressive...
That apple that spoiled the rest
of the world. Because he was actually terrified of his own nature, that if he let his own nature out of the box, it would be grotesque. And it needed controlling. Now, you know, I don't think anybody who's brought up children, they can be naughty, but they're fundamentally good. There is a fundamental goodness, a love that shines from them. And you know, that's really, I think, what is going on here. We need to encourage that view that, no, human nature is good. The process itself is good.
Paul and I went to a black gospel choir's performance the other day, and we just had so much fun.
Mm.
And here were the songs praising Jesus, but it was all so much fun and fast and life, and it was hip, it was, it had beat, it was, they're having so much fun. And I thought, you know, I go to churches. That's what took place, and it's all on there. Yeah,
well, the original Christians had what they called love feasts.
Oh, really? Tell us about that.
Well, who knows what they got up to? We have stories, but that's what they were. One of their gatherings was the idea you got together. They had a love feast, which sounds delightful to me. I'd like to know what went on.
You were given that time machine. You know where you were.
I was there.
We were there looking for a love feast.
Yeah.
Question. We've talked with some of the members of the Jesus Seminar who are looking through the historical Jesus, trying to find him, trying to say, what did he really say, as opposed to, you know, he was a wisdom teacher and all this. Mm-hmm. And we've talked to other researchers who are suggesting that the new body of research shows that Jesus had a twin brother named Thomas, that he married Mary Magdalene, that the family escaped to France, all these details.
Mm-hmm.
With that story later from, you know, French people who wanted to bring in, oh yeah, we are related to Jesus and made up. Jesus Seminar, what are they looking at? A carpenter that had a similar name, but where are these details?
Well, I think let's start with Jesus' twin brother.
Okay.
Because the Gospel of Thomas opens with Jesus saying to his twin brother, Thomas, and for the Gnostics, every single one of us is Jesus' twin.
Oh, it's a metaphor.
Because they are our higher self.
Because their goal was to awaken the Christ within us.
Exactly. So, and again, because we can't escape from this literalism, we assume, you know, as some people have said, well, you know, nobody would create the story of Jesus' twin. It must be true, because, you know,
there it is in black and white.
Yeah, and there's a simple explanation for the resurrection. Jesus was killed, but his twin survived, and everybody thought, ah, oh, it's a miracle. It's all literalism. All of the characters in the story, Mary Magdalene and the disciples, they're all there to explore these ideas. It's like looking at Hamlet, incredibly powerful piece of work, and going, okay, so you've demonstrated that there was no Hamlet, you know, there was no 15th century Danish prince called Hamlet. But surely Rosencrantz and Guildenstern, I mean, they really exist, you know, they turn up in a Tom Stoppard play years later. It's a complete misunderstanding. They're all characters. And the Jesus Seminar, I mean, I have tremendous respect for them. They've done incredible work. But I think they're suffering in this instance from the same dreaded literalism.
You were saying that so many of the academics and the scholars around all of this material knew intuitively, guessed for many centuries what you two are saying, but they just never dared speak it out.
Certainly some of them. I mean, I think it's been a slow, I mean, there's been always people who have said what we're saying, but this is a myth, because actually if you go looking, it kind of gets obvious. But people were frightened of saying too much because their livelihoods were on the line, and of course going farther back, their lives were on the line. I mean, we've got to remember, we can write this book today, it's part of the mark of the world we live in, that we can put this out and not be under immediate threat of being taken away by the church police, which we would have been at any other time.
Mm.
And this is the remarkable thing about now, and we've got to be very grateful for that, and they didn't live in that time. So there is a very strong heritage of people who have made very similar claims to ourselves.
And we have a second hour to spend with Peter Gandy and Timothy Freke talking more about what was that Gnostic understanding of the life journey. Let's explore that further. Here at last, after this tradition has been lost to us for a couple of thousand years, we can put it back on the table, reconstruct it, look at its elements, and see its eternal wisdom. Their books include The Jesus Mysteries and Jesus and the Lost Goddess, both available at the Radio Bookstore. We also have a link to their website. Lots of good stuff on there. Thanks for listening. I'm Marley. We continue with Timothy Freke and Peter Gandy, author of The Jesus and the Lost Goddess, in the earlier book, The Jesus Mysteries, to explore this deep, deep connection between Gnosticism and Christianity. Welcome back. It's good to have you both here.
Hi. Thank you.
I want to explore in this hour just what Gnosticism is. You've demonstrated this interlinking of early Christianity with the Gnostics. You pointed out that there's an outer set of teachings in Christianity and then this inner set of teachings of Christianity. And we really need to understand the basis of Gnosticism, which was widespread and quite extensive historically, to understand what these secret teachings were and how the Jesus story is an allegory for that in the development of the human soul. Let's start with you, Peter, and what is the historic connection between Gnosticism and Christianity?
Well, the roots of Gnosticism, I mean, they go way back, but for our purposes, really, we begin with the pagan world. And by the pagan world, we mean the Greek culture. And the most famous expression, perhaps, of Gnosticism was over the Oracle of Apollo at Delphi, where it was written, "Know yourself." And we know from Plato that Socrates was so challenged when he read this that gave him his whole drive in life to find out, well, who am I and what am I? And that began a philosophical quest which consumed the ancient world. Now, when paganism, when Platonic philosophy was taken over by the Jews, when it was introduced into Jewish culture, they took on this same challenge of know yourself. And out of that comes what is now called Gnostic Christianity, although the Gnostics themselves didn't call themselves Gnostics. And they believed that they had fulfilled this injunction, this pagan injunction of coming to know yourself. And a lot of the Gnostic texts start with the supposition that if you come to know yourself, you will come to know God. In fact, they're quite adamant. Get rid of the quest for God. Look for yourself, and that will, in a paradoxical way, lead to God, because actually the self and God are the same thing. The I that it is in me is the same I that is in you. That is God. That is consciousness. And so when you come to St. Paul, the earliest Christian we know of, and he's talking about the Christ in you, he is talking, or we are all one body. We're all the body of Christ. He's saying that our essential identity for all of us is the divine, is consciousness itself. So it's a continuation, it's a tradition which is, probably goes right back to the Egyptians, comes right forward, of, and the Gnostics are an expression of that same quest for self-knowledge.
And can you say, the basis for Gnosticism that became the Jesus story,
Well, to understand what these myths are about, to understand the secret teachings they're encoding, whether we're talking about the pagan myths or the Christian myths that developed from them, you have to get an idea, as Peter's saying, what the Gnosis was. And you do have this question. I mean, the words are put into the mouth of Jesus in one of the manuscripts. It says, the kingdom of heaven is inside you, and if you know yourself, you will find it. Know yourself. So the knowledge that you're seeking is self-knowledge. And as Peter says, this self-knowledge turns out to be knowledge of God. But what really intrigues us and what we've really explored in the book is, what does that mean? What does it mean to know yourself? Certainly, what does it mean to come to know yourself and find out you're God? And what they're doing, I think, is actually very, 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 very simple, once you get it, which is this. They're saying that there's two ways to understand what you are. One is how you appear to be, on the outside, objectively, and one is how you are for yourself. And what the Gnostics are saying is most of us, most of the time, only pay attention to how we appear to be. So, for instance, if you look at somebody, you'll see a body. That's how they appear to you from the outside. If you watch them long enough, there'll be a body which is either conscious or asleep, and then they'll be conscious again. That's how they look like. And you will be the same. That's from the outside. But what the Gnostics are saying is, pay attention to me, because for you, actually, it's not like that at all, is it, if you think about it? Because from the inside, when you go to sleep, this world disappears. your subjective experience is you find yourself in a completely different world. And when that disappears altogether, you find yourself in a deep sleep state where all is one. So what they're saying is, look from the inside and you will see that it's not consciousness which comes and goes and you're a body. It's actually bodies that come and go. Your body comes and goes from your consciousness. In fact, what you'll discover is that everything which exists for you is in your consciousness. So you end up with these two very, very different ideas of who you are. One is the common sense idea that you are how you appear to others, which is a tiny little body in a vast, vast cosmos. And then how you actually are for yourself, which if you can see it, is consciousness, an emptiness containing everything you experience. This empty space which contains all that is for you. Now the whole message of Gnosticism, and why they say that if you understand this gospel of Gnosis, this gospel of enlightenment, you will, Jesus says in the Gospel of Thomas, I will show you what no one can see, what no one can hear, what no one can touch, which no one can think about. And if you understand this, you will not taste death. That's a hell of a thing to say. But actually, I think all they're saying to us is, discover consciousness. Discover that you are not a body who is conscious, your consciousness that is conscious of being a body. That's how you appear within your consciousness. And if you can turn it around, you will discover you are this big emptiness containing everything. You can't die because you're not born. They call
because
it the unborn.
Because that eternal part of you exists outside time and space.
Yeah, it is, but it's not like a part. It's not like there's part of you in and part of you out. It's saying that as consciousness, you are the mystery. You are the mystery containing everything. And as a body, you are one of the appearances within the mystery. And you can see that in your own immediate experience. And that's what you can't touch, you can't taste, you can't see, you can't hear, you can't think about. It's what's doing the thinking, what's doing the hearing. What you are, essentially, is that mystery.
So the answer to the riddle is part of that inner secret teaching. That's the code to understand the rest of it.
The code is to bring you to this place where they can flip you out of your idea of being the body,
mm-hmm.
which is conscious, which somehow you are inside the body, and go, no, it's the other way around. The body is inside you. Everything is inside you. And if you just look, it's obvious. Everything exists for you, exists within consciousness. Every sensation is a sensation within consciousness. Every thought, every feeling, everything which is a sensation or is an experience within consciousness.
So your experience of other people is that they are bodies with a head. Whereas your experience of yourself is that you don't have a head. You have a huge empty space in which the world appears. And that is your own personal experience of the world. And that's a completely different way of looking at things. It flips the whole common sense understanding on its head, if you like.
So it's rather like the Bushmen who say, we are the dreamer who is dreaming us.
Yeah,
very much. So you've got this idea that, excuse me, that your center is the center. That everything's coming, that what's looking out through Laura and what's looking back through Tim is the same mystery, looking at itself.
And this is the basis of all ethical conduct. Once you realize that it's not another person out there, it is exactly the same consciousness in them as is in you. It's just that consciousness, that pure beingness, which the Gnostics call I am, and many traditions call I am, just that sense of being, is the same in them. What happens is we then go, I am Peter. I am Tim. I am, and that's the quality that we attach to consciousness. But in the beginning, it's just pure, simple consciousness, which then becomes attached to a particular expression, a particular face, a particular manifestation of that consciousness. And what they're trying to get you to do is to become aware of awareness itself, the fact that you are aware, and to lose contact with that particular quality. Well, maybe not to lose contact with it, but just become aware of that beingness that is in you. It's like, I mean, you have a taste of it in the morning when you wake up, and before there's any idea of who you are and what you are, there is simple, I am. It's only then that you get, I am late for work, or I am hungry, or I am whatever, a quality attached to consciousness. what the Gnostics are trying to explore is conscious, pure consciousness that is not attached to any object, that is not, that we all share, we all are here, we all share in beingness.
A true sense of unity, and if the goal is to all become Christ, then that definition would be awakened consciousness still living out its ordinary existence.
Yeah,
well, in the image, we can actually begin to understand what they mean by the resurrected Christ with this image, because, as you're saying, the Christ is a symbol for the one consciousness in all. So if you go back in our previous conversation, we were talking about the fundamental myth being the dazzling darkness of pure consciousness, conscious of nothing, waking up by projecting itself as experience, something to be conscious of, looking at itself in a mirror, if you like to use an analogy. Well, the problem is, if you like, God wakes up, looks at himself in a mirror to see and see the world, and then looks in the mirror and goes, I'm that, with every single person, every single being, which is, we are that. God looks in the mirror, I'm that. The spiritual journey is the journey of waking up, it's like, oh no, I'm not that, I'm what's looking in the mirror. I'm not the reflection. I'm not what the ancients called the eidolon, or the image. So our problem, my problem is I'm the one consciousness of the universe, the Christ, looking in the mirror and going, I'm Tim. Until I go, no, I'm not Tim. I appear to be Tim, but actually, I'm this big empty space. I'm this consciousness. I'm this mystery, which is aware of Tim. I'm the thing that's looking in the mirror, not the image in the mirror.
It's quite a witnessing experience.
It is a pure witnessing experience.
And a lot of people, when we discuss this at talks, go, I see you understand this from Buddhism. Well, that's not accidental, because some of the earliest writers, some of the earliest Gnostic Christians, were also specialists in Hinduism and Buddhism and all the other things that were at work in Alexandria at the time. So all of these things were being synthesized, and it's not surprising that it has elements of Buddhism in it, because actually there's just one perennial philosophy, and this is it.
So then you can return to images like the resurrected Christ and go, aha, you know, the traditional picture, isn't it, is the idea that a man came, he was God, he had to be killed for some reason, he then came back from the dead, and if you believe that, then when you die, you will go to heaven. Well, it couldn't be farther from the original Christians intended by this image. And one of the reasons for that is that the issue of heaven and hell doesn't arise for them, because this is the underworld. We're dead now. The Gnostic idea, you're dead to who you really are. I'm dead to who I really am, and we are therefore in the underworld. When we identify with the body,
this earth can appear as hell at certain moments, right?
Absolutely. Well, they have an image, a fantastic image, which you find in a lot of Gnostic traditions, of a circle with a spot in the center, and that's consciousness, looking out along the radii, which is your experience, your psyche, or your soul, at your body, which is on the circumference. And here we are, we're looking out at the circumference, and we just think we're the circumference. That's what it is to be dead, to think we're a separate individual living in the world only. And when we're in that world, then we suffer. And that's very, very lonely place to be.
That separate self is born to die. So that is...
Thank God it's just a temporary existence in that state.
Yeah.
Yeah. At the center, there's the one center. You imagine that circle with an infinite number of radii, each finding a different body at the circumference. And that's us. That's what's happening in this conversation. We are two of those radii meeting in the world.
In a sea of radii.
Yeah, absolutely. But with one center. Now, the Christ is the center. That's their name for the center. So we are the dead Christ in the underworld. When we resurrect, which they say can only happen now, not when you're dead, you'll find you're in heaven. To be in heaven is to know that you're the center. It's not to have lost the circumference. Because if you lose the circumference, you'll fall asleep. You won't be conscious of anything. You do that every night. Every night, if you like, you withdraw from the circumference to the center. And as you withdraw along the radio, you're in a dream world. And then you get to the center and it's all one. And then you come back again. But the nothing is to be in all of them at once. Because then you can know the one. So, the resurrected Christ, to be in the world but not of it. This is what Jesus says. The image. You're in the world, you're a body, but you're not of it. Actually, you're the center of consciousness. That's your unborn.
And it's transcendent.
Yes, it's literally transcendent.
Because as long as the center forgets itself and thinks that it is a body on this wheel, and Pythagoreans call it the wheel of suffering, because it just goes round, and that body is doomed to die. As long as you identify with that, life seems completely meaningless, and you have death. But as long as you can come to understand that the consciousness in you gave birth to the body that you are, that body has itself appeared in your consciousness. It is not you, but all you've done is identify with it.
So all of those themes, and you see them everywhere, of death and rebirth that goes on in the ancient world, they weren't just celebrating, gee, winter comes and the plants die and then they spring up again in the spring and etc. They're really looking at the fact that you are dying to your present existence and you are being reborn, you are transcending to a larger understanding and experience.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, take the Jesus story. Jesus is born into a cave, a catalima, we get told stable, but cave. He's born into a cave. That's us, born into the underworld.
And it's dark.
And it's dark, and you know, the light's hidden from you and all the rest of it. But it's Plato's cave. It's an image which would have been so well known in the ancient world, it would have been the equivalent of me saying to you, lightsaber. And I wouldn't have to say to most people, you know, from the film Star Wars, you've just got that straight away. And in the same way, you could say, born into a cave, because all the god men were born into caves, and the image would be, I know what that means.
Well, they also had those cairns, right? Meaning, let it sleep with them.
Mm-hmm.
And was that another symbolic?
I imagine that it's exactly what it would have been, a pre echo of this.
Okay, go ahead.
And so you've got a journey in the Jesus story between someone being born into a cave of a virgin, of the goddess, and going through an initiatory life until they meet their death. They die to the idea of the body, of the self, and when we go back to the cave, when Mary Magdalene comes to the cave, it's empty. Suddenly, Christ is no longer in the cave. He's escaped the cosmos, and that's the journey. Again, another version of the journey, which is about you're born into the world, but you need to wake up to the fact that actually it seems like you're in the world, but actually the world is in you. And again, I feel what the biggest revelation for me, personally in this whole process, is when the mystics and Gnostics say that, it's not an idea. It is an idea, the words are an idea, but what they're pointing to is just the way it is if you look.
And an experience?
It's a direct experience. If you look, you can see that you are emptiness of consciousness containing everything which is for you.
Well, so some of those mystical experiences can be described as, I was full of the nothingness and I was full of the everything simultaneously.
Precisely, because they are the same thing. Peter said about the Buddhist tradition, they have the nirvana for the emptiness, samsara for the play of forms and appearances, and then the highest teaching is nirvana is samsara, samsara is nirvana.
And what unity to have a foot in both worlds, the alphas and the omegas simultaneously.
Yeah, to bring those together. I mean, so much of that seems to be the real genius of the Gnostics, is that they brought these two things together, and those two things are epitomized for them by Jesus and the goddess, by these two things. They're the basis of all opposites. It's why we're divided into male and female. It's why the world has light and dark. There are all of these opposites. And so often in the spiritual path, because having outlined, okay, there are these two powers for both of us. There is the body and the spirit. There is physical materiality, but then there are also the ideas which are all invisible. Your consciousness, which is really the essence of you, is completely invisible. You can't take an idea out of my head and look at it here on a table. It's invisible. So these two things of visibility and invisibility coming together. Now, many spiritual traditions have the same thing, that this world, as Tim said, is samsara, it's illusory, and that what you should try and do is get away from that to nirvana, which is the ultimate reality.
The Gnostics would say it's all right here.
They would say bring those two things together, that they are both true. That you are both a body in the world, and the world is in the body.
That's a wonderful paradox, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah, it's like a mind twister that really grapples that.
The image they have, there's the whole of the body. I mean, what we do in Jesus and the Lost Goddess is we reconstruct the whole of Christian mythology, which the Jesus story is just a very small part. the bit that comes at the end, and it's an echo of this incredible body of mythology which carries these two figures, Christ and the Goddess, which represents this fundamental duality all the way through from the beginning of the beginning to the idea of the end of time. And the idea that they're leading to is the mystical marriage of Jesus and the Goddess. And then, this is a beautiful image, I think, because in the idea of marriage, you have this idea of two people becoming one, and yet they remain two. And I think that is the essence of what the Gnostics are saying, that what this is, this experience we call life, is the one become many to know that it's one. But it must become many to know that it's one. It must wake up and therefore be conscious and therefore be in duality to know that it's one. That's the root of the paradox. It has to be two to know it's one. That is so strange, but when you can see that, then you can't push anything away. And yet, there's a marriage. You can bring them together, and yet have them separate at the same time.
A couple of questions. There was a researcher in England, and I saw a documentary where he was going back to some of the megalithic sites, and he was saying, gosh, look at these phallic stones, mm-hmm. and then look at these more female stones. They have these very different shapes and textures and all of this. Now, wasn't it interesting when the full moon and the sun and the horizon and all of this, you have this shadow play where it looks like they're marrying, they're coming mm-hmm. together in this union, and here's this mystical marriage, and you find this mystical marriage such a very, very ancient idea.
Yes.
So is this what it's saying about this marriage of opposites, complements? And then you get the child born of it, which would be the Trinity. Mm-hmm. So it seems to me the whole universe is evolving through our very experience and existence.
Yeah.
Is this an evolving, eternal universe that's continually growing more rich, more...
In philosophy, it's called dialectics. And in the modern age, this is traced to Hegel, the idea that you have thesis, which throws up its antithesis, which results in a new synthesis.
So it's like how we walk.
Exactly.
Precisely.
Foot in front of the other. One's resting while one is active. There's an opposite.
What you start to find is it's absolutely in everything. Mm. Once you get this vision, everywhere you look, you will see this being played out.
Sounds like it's called life, the process of life force.
And Plato, you know, he's full of this dialectical, if you look at everything, the weaker, the stronger come from the weaker. The taller come from the smaller. The heavier come from the lighter. And so it is, you know, day turns inexorably into night, which turns inexorably into day.
And they need each other in order to propel.
Is turning into its opposite. And he goes on to say, you know, to use this as an argument for the existence of life after death, or the continuation of life after death. Because he says, look, you can quite clearly see that the dead come from the living. The living turn inexorably into the dead.
Therefore, we must reincarnate
and the dead
keep living.
Turn the next be into the living.
Oh, what good news.
Mm.
Not that I ever believed that once you die, you're a blip off the screen forever, but...
Mm. Well, I think, I mean, that's the whole essence of the Christian message is about immortality.
And then we have this life after death and the rebirth and the resurrection.
Yeah, it's finding, it's two things, I think. One is it's going, look, it's saying that the essence of you that is experiencing everything you're experiencing is not itself an experience. It's not in time. Your being is exactly the same qualityless mystery that it's always been, from when you were very small, through the whole of your life, and then you talk to old people, and they will tell you this. The sense of being that you have remains the same. And it remains the same because it has no qualities. It's a mystery because it's not in time. It is in eternity, witnessing what's in time. It is, as I said previously, what the Gnostics called your unbornness. And this is a hell of a message. You can't die, possibly, because you weren't ever born. What was born was your appearance of the body, and that sure as hell will die. But that's not you. That is your changing appearance. And it's dying and being reborn all the time. It's changing all the time. And one day it will wear out, and you will, just like you do every night, you will disappear back into the one, and then re-emerge as something else, which you do every morning. And
we all need a vacation? That could be fun.
Yeah, I mean, that's amazing. I love it.
Yeah, and I think...
Well, let's not be so frightened of death, and yeah. If we can get over that, then we can make the more of our life here. Yeah. And also, it would change our behavior to know, gosh, we're going to come back to this world.
Mm. Well, one thing...
So
one thing
let's trash it while we're here.
Absolutely. I mean, the thing that's occurred to me recently is that we're taking short-term solutions like, oh, these Bin Laden or, you know, these terrorists, and they're doing terrible things, which they are. If we could just kill them all off, then it would be a lot better, which it may be, I don't know, in the short term. But if this understanding is correct, it's really just saddling our children with the problem, because these mindsets, this will come back. These souls, these ways of perceiving reality will come back in a new form, in a new place, and work their way through again. The only way that we will stop the hatred or the confusion is by addressing where consciousness has got stuck, where it's got tied up in a little knot, and identified with a whole lot of crazy ideas. Because otherwise it will just keep on repeating and repeating and repeating and repeating.
If this was our central philosophy, again, can we imagine how we would behave differently? Look at medicine rather than, oh, let's cut out this diseased part.
Yeah.
It would be, well, no, we need to heal it and bring it back into the whole and let it remember that it is part of it, and let's work in harmony.
Yeah.
You have the complementary modalities as opposed to Western medicine. Let's kill it.
Yeah.
How would we go about agriculture instead of killing the insects? You know, what would we do differently rather than war? Well, we are dropping the food today. Afghani people, so we're trying to help.
Yeah,
so we're happy
there. Oh, we're definitely moving in the right direction. You know, the whole vision of Christianity is that we have this outer and we have this inner. And the inner journey is to transcend and to find out what you really are, because that will change how you act in the world. And collectively in the world, this is the mirror of God, and it wants to be perfect itself. It wants to create heaven on earth. It wants to bring these two together. And I think the more conscious you become, the more you can feel that impulse to try and bring about a better world, to make it a world of love and of knowledge and a world in which we can awaken. And that is what is trying to happen. And I look around me, and for all the imperfections of the world, I have to say I think it's moving in that direction.
And people will find out how optimistic you are about where we're going and the state of the world when we come back. And we continue with Timothy Freke and Peter Gandy. Their books, those books include Jesus and the Lost Goddess. I want to find out more about this Lost Goddess when we come back. Also, the Jesus Mysteries. We have a link to Peter and Timothy's website. In the meantime, you can get their books at the radio bookstore. You know, I used to think that it was time for men to step aside as they ruled the world and have done so for many thousands of years. And look at the mess they got us into. It's like, okay, guys, you had your chance. Step down. Let the women take over, because we know about harmony and making everybody happy and having everybody have their say and creating truth circles and all that. But I really think that the real answer is putting the goddess back in her place, putting things back into balance.
Mm.
And I'd love to hear more about the Lost Goddess as it relates to the Jesus story.
The goddess was such an important part of the ancient world. You only have to go back to the real precursor of the Jesus story, which is the story of Osiris in ancient Egypt. He's a man, a god who becomes a man, he dies at the hands of the forces of evil, he resurrects, he's going off to become the judge of the afterlife court. This is the prototype of the Jesus story. Highly important, vital as a part of this, is the story of Isis. She's co-equal with him. She is the one who actually brings him back to life. And so it is in the Greek world. You have tremendous, you know, stories of tremendous goddess figures. And it seems to us, I mean, what has happened with the Jesus story is, as has happened with other things that turned religion, is that it's become politicized. And the dominant political force at the time was men, and particularly Roman men. And for them, women playing a part in religion was not possible. So what happened is that half of the story has been cut out. Half of the important... And it's, I mean, it is still there. If you look at the Jesus story itself, women play an incredibly important part in it. Right from the very first miracle, the turning of the water into wine, that's Mary, Jesus' mother, who orders him to do it. Then you have the meeting of Jesus with the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman at the well. You have Mary Magdalene anointing Jesus. You have the women at the cross, all the male disciples all run away. It is only the women who are faithful who are there at the cross. And the first person who discovers the resurrection is Mary Magdalene. So these elements are in there, but they're not given the stress, the importance that the Gnostics placed on them. And what we try to do is to bring back all of this, the divine feminine, because it's important not just for women, but I think also for men. Men have been denied.
You have your share of estrogen.
Exactly. Men have been denied a relationship with the divine feminine as much as women have. So I think, you know, it is very important that these two things come back into balance, come back into harmony.
When you have a society like the Greeks that really celebrated these deep mysteries, but in their society, and I know that the Greek history is a long one, but what I've read about the status of Greek women was that they were married women, were shut up, cloistered. They couldn't get out and go to the parties and have the interesting discussions, and then those were left to prostitutes that were there for entertainment, and the best of them were educated and could carry on a nice conversation. That really the men got to really run the society, and women were relegated into this cloistered existence. I wonder, how is it that you can have a society that celebrates equality in the mysteries, but doesn't play it out in the actual status of the women?
Well, again, we're dealing with, you know, if you take the where this all begins, which is in the mysteries, which were imported into Greece from Egypt, by the Pythagoreans, the followers of Pythagoras. Now, for them, women had absolute equality. One of the extraordinary things about the Pythagorean communities was that they were made up of men and women who were completely equal. And this tradition continues right down through the Gnostic Christians. For them, women preach, they heal, they teach, they are equal to men. So in these, in the trees and through into Gnosticism, that radical equality prevails. They are pushing for a social program of equality between men. Because having outlined a philosophy, which is all about bringing the opposites together. You couldn't do anything but that.
And it shows you how very central our cosmologies are and the trickle-down effect they have into so many aspects of how we set up our societies.
That's right, but as you pointed out, with any, once that becomes fixed, once it becomes a religion, then it's perfectly possible to live in a state of utter hypocrisy. So just in the same way as we can have a culture which calls itself Christian and is based on the idea of replacing the maxim of an eye for a tooth for a tooth with the idea of loving your enemies, still actually practicing an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. So in the same way the Greeks may have as a little mystery the idea of the goddess and her relationship with her divine consort, and yet actually in practice still practice spiritual women as second-class citizens or worse. So what you've got to see, what you'll see in the ancient world, as you'll see today, is that when these ideas come down, you know, the number of people that hold true to them, well, they are the Gnostics. The people who are trying to hold true to these ideas is what makes someone a Gnostic. When they become just lip service and people go about their business as normal, that's when you've got religion or ideology.
But let's define what is normal. Was there a time when matriarchies ruled and were just as autocratic at times as patriarchies?
Well, all of the mythology that's come down from theoretically matriarchal cultures have been of an eternal goddess and her consort who is sacrificed. And
sounds like the Black Widow spider here.
Well, yeah, I mean, there have been many books written on this phenomenon, that for women, blood is not the end of life as it is for men. Women associate blood with new life, the potential for new life. So I think it's, but as regards whether there have been matriarchies, I'm not so sure, but what my gut feeling is that we're now, or certain sectors of the modern world, are elaborating a myth of a benevolent matriarchal period when the living was easy, fruit just fell off the trees, nobody had to work for a living.
We're all looking for that safe spot to live.
We're looking for that, but it's a fantasy, I think. It's a fantasy that we're retrojecting onto the past.
Sorry, Greg. It's also interesting to look around and see how any mindset of mistaking, as you pointed out earlier, the symbol for the actual inner mystery can lead you into trouble, and how any society can say, gee, it's our honor to sacrifice you. Let's put you up in a mountaintop and knock you over the head, or give you some drug and leave you there to freeze, or leave you a mountaintop, because we'll send you to the gods. Let's sacrifice you because, gee, blood is reborn, and we're going to make you reborn. Let's tear out your heart and give it to the sun god. Gee, that's an honor. It's scary, the types of honor. Let's question you and say that we're protecting you. Let's put you up on a pedestal to not let you participate in society.
Religion, you may get twisted. I think we can safely say, you know, that religion has always been that. And yet there has always been individuals, usually persecuted by religion. And, you know, right from Pythagoras and Socrates and these ancient figures through to the original Christians, and then the portrayal of Jesus as somebody who is persecuted by the religious authorities. I mean, that's the character. He's somebody who goes in and confronts the religious authorities. He's rude to them. He deliberately heals people on the Sabbath, which you shouldn't do, to show how mad the laws are. He feeds his disciples. They let them take wheat on the Sabbath to show how mad these laws are. He confronts the leaders of the religion and calls them fools, and he is top of the, look at him in the temple. I mean, he is a Gnostic. He is painted as this radical freak. He hangs out with all the wrong people, prostitutes, tax collectors, the outcasts. He's the idealized Gnostic, and he is persecuted for that. And that's the figure they've created in this incredible vision of this figure Jesus. But he knows people who actually did exist, people like Socrates, who upset the religious authorities. This is what it is to be a Gnostic, is to stand out against this and go, no, this is not it. This is not it. This is what divides us. This is crazy. What it's about is in this, it's the mystery of this moment now, and waking up from the illusion of thinking you know what life is, into the reality of knowing that life is a profound mystery.
The other tendency in gender is that we like to complicate things so much. We thought it was such a simple idea, and yet we're willing to go to the ends of the earth looking for something that was right there within us all along. We like to make more and more laws, more and more rituals, more and more complications, so that we really get lost in our stuff.
Well, once you set off on a trajectory which is mistaken, the further you go, the more mistaken it becomes. And the more the holes start opening up, and the more you've got to cover them up. Oh, you cover it with this and this, and you've just got to bring in more and more, which is why all systems of thought, from science and mysticism, want to find beauty and truth in simplicity. The simpler you can make your understanding in math or physics, the simpler you can make the equation, the closer you are to getting to it, because we all know intuitively that what's true and beautiful and right is going to be simple. And eventually, mystics are saying, you come back until you've got the two, and then you've got the one. And so you're just working your way back to greater simplicity. The mistake is to think that's not sophisticated. Very sophisticated understanding, but very simple, rather than what we find with the religious understanding, which tends to be the opposite. It tends to be very, very complicated and incredibly superficial, because it's not based on anything. It's just a set of ideas.
When we look at other spiritual traditions that are trying very hard to get to the heart of the mystery, we see a lot of confusion over the role of the material world and the role of the body, and I think the final absurd end result of that is to think that women are evil.
They all go together, really. I think there's a whole complex of beliefs which say, as we've mentioned, the spiritual path is about getting away from the world, but that's a temporary thing. It's in order to come back to it with renewed, to understand what it is. But there's a whole complex of ideas that you see marked out, I mean, in Christianity, but also in other religions, of associating the world with the female, with sex. It becomes a whole constellation of issues that have to be rejected, that you have to get away from. And that's a complete misunderstanding of the whole, because the body is the foundation for all of this. As the, you know, we said about the Gnostic path, it starts with building a body. Then building an ego. Then going out into the realm of the spirit. So the body, the world, is the foundation for all of this. Without a world, without a body, you could not experience any of this. I mean, if you go back to the initial analogy which they play with, this looking into a mirror, we each one of us is looking into the mirror, or the one is looking into the mirror, then once you look into the mirror and you go, what I'm looking at is an illusion, well, the solution isn't to get rid of the mirror, because then you won't get anything. And that's what's happening when people try and push away the body or push away the world. They're going to knock themselves back into just unconsciousness. The narrative is to look in the mirror and go, I'm the thing which is looking, which is a totally different thing. It's inclusive of the mirror. It's seeing that you're projecting yourself into the mirror. And that allows the body, as Peter said, then becomes absolutely central. Not something to get rid of, something which is your opportunity, without which you couldn't be having this amazing journey of awakening.
I'm like you, gentlemen. I'm a generalist and I'm an inclusionist. So my response is it's not either or, it's all of the above, and let's try to find it all working together.
Yeah.
You mentioned that Jung had a statement about this...
he defines the Western attitude as being always going either or, but the Eastern attitude was both and. What we're constantly trying to do in life is to choose one side of the equation and reject the other. We want life, but we don't want death. We want youth, but we don't want old age. We want good, but we don't want bad. We're constantly trying to select, not realizing that all of these things are totally interconnected. One is turning steadily into the other and back again. And that to be whole, you have to be able to embrace both.
All of the events.
All of it. And that is a whole life. And as long as you're trying to make a distinction between yes and no, you will always end up with only half of the story. And you'll be disappointed.
And you'll think the glass is half full, and you'll be very frustrated by the other ways today.
Exactly. And that is the root of all human frustration. When you try to bring them both together and honor both sides.
Trust the process.
Then you have integration, you have wholeness.
So much of this journey feels as about just, it doesn't change anything actually. It just takes you to a place where you realize that it was perfect all along. That it had to be this way. It had to have all these aspects.
But it's more fun living in a storyline on a stage, happy with your script and your part in it, than to be constantly struggling at or trying to rewrite it or fight against it. So you have only, I have only so much time, which is like real estate, life force, which, you know, is like a bank account, and how am I going to spend this? Where am I going to put my efforts? How am I going to enjoy my life and make the most of it? I have to be happy with the lot that I've been given, and not only that, but to realize the mystery of it, the awe of it, the potential of it, that when you step inside of it and you suddenly feel the ripple and it's exciting and you go, okay, it's right here. I am the center of my own universe. Mm. So you of yours, you of yours, you of yours. Then it becomes like a whole constellation where you're sitting out looking around all these other stars and it's, you know, you're present, it's immediate. It's a much richer experience. Oh, I'm on the adventure. It's right here. I don't have to go looking here under this rock or here under this one. It's right here.
Absolutely. Yeah. So much of the, well, of all really good spiritual traditions, what they do is they should bring back, you go on a journey, perhaps away from the world, perhaps you need to do that for a while. A lot of spiritual traditions are about retreat, going on retreat.
And you appreciate it for more,
exactly.
Coming home then.
But many spiritual traditions don't bring you back to you as you are, living in the world as it is. What they bring you to is the tradition itself. They have no intention, once a particular master or mistress has got hold of you, they have no intention of letting you go. And it's almost like bad parenting. Good spiritual parenting is about taking individuals who are needy, but not keeping them in your spiritual club forever and ever and ever, sort of preparing them for that maturity where they then go out into the world. And the Gnostic path is very much about that, because its ultimate truth is not that heaven is elsewhere. Heaven is here, right now, as Jesus says in the Gospel of Thomas. The kingdom of heaven is laid out across the world, but people do not see it. And it says, and that is the simple truth. And if you're entering the spiritual path because you actually want to get away from who you are and the world as it is, then saying to somebody like that, no, it's you as you are in the world as
that
it is,
look pretty.
Is not what they want to hear.
Dismal, yeah.
They have to go on a journey. in order to come back to the most obvious thing, the thing that's staring them in the face, that they are, that it is, and to achieve reconciliation with that, and love of that, and saying, I actually want to be here. This is what I want. And you often, I mean, people moan about life all the time, they're complaining. But if they were told, well, sorry, you've got 6 weeks to live, suddenly that attitude would change, and they would become aware of all the things that they're profoundly in love with, and they would love to live. Now, it really is just about getting that attitude now.
What an important distinction, thank you. Because that's like the prodigal soul coming home, finally, and appreciating it for what it was.
Yeah.
We've all been on those journeys. We've been journeying since day one, seeking this. We're driven to seek it out. But isn't that the same drive that this real consciousness had to go outside itself, to then come back into itself, a fuller, awakened step? Isn't that a necessary step? Isn't a step function in the whole process?
Yeah,
like putting one foot in front of the other, you go away, then you bring yourself back up.
I mean, it seems to me that is the experience of life. I mean, if you see a woman giving birth, it can look like the ultimate tragedy. There's chaos, there's pain, there's crying, there's blood, there's... And what you
separation.
Have...
Separation?
Yeah, what you have is separation. One, a thing which was one is now being broken into two, and there is all the grief and pain of that separation. But without that separation, there cannot be any new life. There cannot be a new journey for every one of us has come from that profound separation. But it's the journey back to integration into that. And that's why you have in the Jesus story, the womb and the tomb. Jesus is, as Tim said, is born into a cave, which is symbolic of the mother. But he dies and is placed in a tomb. And it's the womb and the tomb. These are both your mother gives you your birth, the possibility for life, but also bequeaths you your death and all the suffering that you will experience. It's all wrapped up together.
You know, so many ancient burials were all about setting one up for rebirth. So many rebirthalisms incorporated into burials and tombs, weren't there?
Yeah.
So, was this an understanding? Was this an innate instinct? Was this wishful thinking? Was this, gee, I better hedge my bets? What do you think it was? Way.
I think there's always been a deep intuition of rebirth, but I think it comes from an understanding which is much more prevalent in the ancient cultures, and especially the shamanic cultures, that of understanding life through sympathy, the idea that things are resonating with each other and the patterns that work themselves out here are the same patterns that work themselves out here. It's basically of astrology. As above, so below. The stars move in certain ways, that reflects what will happen here. But it's on everything is relating to everything else in a meaningful patterned way. So the pattern that we experience of our lives, the coming and going of consciousness day and night, is the pattern of between lives as well. So I think there's always been a deep intuition that the experience returns, that there'll always be continuity and there will always be change. Some part of us, the essence of us, is always the same. And the experience of who we are constantly changes and is wakes up and goes to sleep and becomes somebody else is reborn, whatever that means. I mean, you've got to remember that for the Gnostics, the whole of reality is a part of dream. It is a part of dream. So it just means you're reimagining yourself in a new situation, in a new way.
And perhaps
you shouldn't think of it as coming back here, as if this was a place where you could come back to, because this is all within consciousness for them. It's all part of the dream. You just reimagine yourself. And you're doing that all the time. You're imagining.
Joy! What an adventure!
Oh yeah, it's adventure. I mean, it's ultimate adventure. I mean,
and it's never going to get boring, and it's always going to be new and different and change.
I mean, it really is, and that's what.
That's so intense.
Ultimately, that's what all of these traditions are trying to point to. It's an incredible world. The mere fact that you are and that it is enough. I mean, Tim and I quite often say to us, it's no longer a case of why it is, or how it is, or when it is, or where it is. It's simply that it is.
And you know, when you cover that over, that mist, it's a bit like, I think everyone's experienced this when they're in love. You fall in love with somebody, and it's fantastic, and they're a mystery, and the love is a mystery. And then over time, you start thinking you know who they are, and you know what your relationship is about, and then it starts going dry. And where did the mystery go? And where did the magic go? And it goes dead on you. And then it can be finished. And it's the same with your relationship with life. and your relationship with yourself. When you think you know who you are, and when you think you know what life is, you kill it. You kill it, it's just like a love affair.
Surprise.
But when you open up and you go and you acknowledge the constant moment-to-moment mystery of what is, then you can be having a love affair with yourself and a love affair with life.
Or as you dedicate your book, this is dedicated to the good in you, and this is dedicated to those who know that they don't know.
Yes, indeed.
Because then you have something new to discover, and you're back in the center of the journey.
You're in the mystery. It's saying that the beginning and the end of the spiritual journey is the mystery.
So the good news is that, you know, God and the goddess have it all covered. Trust the process. It's going to happen. You're here. Just wake up to it and enjoy it.
Mm.
And so that's very comforting.
Yeah, I think we should be very comforted. I think the message from the Gnostics and the message that anyone can find out for themselves if they make the journey is that what this is coming from, what this is an expression of, is pure goodness, is pure love, is pure consciousness.
And where you are is just where you should be.
Absolutely.
There is
nowhere else to go.
This is the ultimate okay message, right?
Absolutely.
You're okay. You're right on the path. It's all happening. Don't worry about it.
We actually saw a book at one time having gone through these incredibly elaborate myths, which they are, and quite complex philosophy, which it is. We come around at the end of saying, so they say themselves, this isn't complex. How can this be? And yet we kind of see that the message, when you really see it, is just as you said, Lloyd, the message is everything's okay. And actually, that's what we all need to hear.
Mm-hmm.
What we desperately need to hear is, okay, but then you go, it's okay. And then you can exist in the mystery. If you know it's okay, you're not frightened of the mystery. If you think it's not okay, that's when the mystery is terrifying.
Thank you so much. And it is so good to have this ancient wisdom tradition back on the surface where we can enjoy it, learn from it, delve deep into it. Come to appreciate its message. It's okay. Everything's fine. It's all under control. You're all okay. I'm so pleased by that message. Thank you, God. Thank you, Goddess. And thank you, Timothy and Peter. That was Timothy Freke and Peter Gandy. Their books include This Is Must Reading, The Jesus Mysteries, and Jesus and the Lost Goddess. Go on another spiritual adventure. Enrich your life and enjoy the journey. Those books are available at the Radio Bookstore. Thanks for listening.